happy to invite Ms. P. Saranya, Assistant Professor, Department of English, to share her tips on effective communication and facts of English language. Welcome, ma'am.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning, ma'am.
Okay, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Happy to meet you in the virtual through virtual mode. So then for the 13th induction program, day 2 series. Okay, let me introduce myself. I am Saranya, Department of English. So today we'll discuss about effective communication and facts of English language. So before that, I wish to say about our department. Just a minute. Okay. I'm happy to share a few words about our department. Our department have a well-equipped lab, which has E-class software. It's an advanced level of software, which connect all the system through server. Then our department have certain activities such as Thinker Association and Inoya and Search and SAT. Through this activity, we enable the students to bring their imagination and integrative talents. So apart from that, to improve students' communication, we are conducting spoken English class for the students. So in a regular college, those who are willing to enrich your communication, you can join the spoken English class. Then another one is Women Empowerment Cell. Mrs. J. Mary McLean Rexella, Head Department of English, she is the coordinator of the cell. So in this cell, our college conducting various programs to empower the girl students. Then our college published our college magazine, which is named as the Melange, biannually. So I am happy to share with you. So our department has a contribution to make this magazine in a successful manner. So the next one is Team Talk, the Massive Hackathon. This is an event we are conducting every year for 11th and 12th students. It's a speech competition. So through this, just we bring the students skills in orating skills. So then our department conducted an international conference with the collaboration of other departments such as Tamil, Maths, BCA and CS. So we conducted national and international workshops. So we had the resource person from international forums such as Canada, Sri Lanka and US. So during this pandemic situation, we conducted e-poetry competition. Then we have conducted two national webinars and a power webinar in the academic year 2020. So in this academic year 2021, we organized two international webinars. So we had the resource person from Iran. So I'm happy to see you in this session. So then before we get into the communication, just I will share some few facts of English language. So what is language? Just a minute, it took some time to change my slide. Just a minute. is my screen is visible to you?
Yes, ma'am.
There was some problem in sharing my slides. Thank you. So then what's the language?
ஏய் அவங்க பேசுறதே ஒண்ணும் கேட்கல
மேம் வாய்ஸ் கேட்கல மேம்
ஆம் ஐ ஆடிபிள் நவ
எஸ் மேம்
ஓகே ஓகே ஹூ வேர் 1132 மில்லியன் ஸ்பீக்கர்ஸ் இன் தி வேர்ல்ட் யூஸ் இங்கிலீஷ் ஆஸ் அ ஃபர்ஸ்ட் லாங்குவேஜ் ஆர் அ செகண்ட் லாங்குவேஜ் So English is considered as the second most spoken language after Mandarin. Mandarin, it plays the first place. English is used as the official language of 67 countries and 27 non-sovereign entities. So in 2020, this they had the statistics over the most spoken language. The five most spoken languages are English, Mandarin, Chinese, Spanish, and French. So over 1132 million people they speak English language 1117 million people they use Mandarin language 971 million people use Chinese language 534 million people use Spanish language and 280 million people they use French language so in this order the Tamil language which is mother tongue for our state it occupies the 19th place which has 81 million speakers we are a Tamil language it occupies the 19th place all over the world so then next words and dictionary we know that we just come across a dictionary from our childhood days to till present so the dictionary is sense book which is our electronic form So then in the dictionary, the words are arranged in alphabetical order. In the dictionary, we got information related to a word. Then we'll get the definition. Then we'll have the pronunciation, and we have a transcription symbols also. The first English dictionary was published in 1755 AD. So then we have so many dictionaries for that. So we have English to English dictionary, Tamil to Tamil dictionary, English to Tamil and Tamil to English dictionary. So then it's better to use English to English dictionary to know the vocabulary. So then we have so many dictionaries such as Oxford, Cambridge and Lithgow dictionary. So in Oxford dictionary, so then 171,476 words which we are using in our day-to-day life. So in Oxford dictionary, 47,156 words are not in use, it's in absolute manner. So then each and every word we have a root word. We call that is a base word. For example, able, it's a root word. So by adding the prefix or suffix, every new word is formed. We call that as a word formation. For example, when we know that prefix or the combination of letter which we add in front of before the root word. So suffix are the group of letter which we add next to the root word. For example, the word able. So when we add the prefix and we have the word unable. So when we add the suffix ity, suffix ity to the root word able, we have ability. So this is how the new words are formed. So based on the word formation, every 2 hours, once a new word is added in the dictionary. So then 14 words are added in a day to the dictionary. So then every new word will be put in the dictionary between now and to the next meal. So during the course of the year, almost 4,000 words are added to the dictionary. So the day by day, the number of words in the dictionary are added. So that's why every year 4,000 new words are added to the dictionary. So based on the word formation, we have certain terms. So in that, just I wish to share only few terms to you. So then first one is a pangram. Some of you might be familiar to this term. So then in a sentence which contain every letter in the alphabet is same termed as the pangram. So here I have given an example in my slide that the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy duck. So in this sentence, we can see all the English alphabets are there. Some letter, it might be a repetition. So this sentence, the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy duck, contain every letters in the alphabet. Just I wish to quote one more example for this. Also, the five boxing wizards jumps quickly. For this sentence, it contains every letter of the alphabet. So this is called as a pangram. So only we have few sentences. It's based on the pangram. So the next one is palindrome. There are certain words. So when we read from left to right or right to left, we have the same spelling. So then as I mentioned here, an example that is radar and madam. So when we read the word radar from right to left, we have the spelling R-A-D-A-R. So when we read it from right to left, we have the same spelling that is R-A-D-A-R. So we have so many examples in this term. We have single word palindrome and multiple word palindrome also. The single word palindrome example is radar and madam. So multiple word palindrome, the example for it is top spot and my gym. So we have longest unique palindromic sentence which contains 21,012 words. So this longest unique palindromic sentence was designed by Peter Norving in 2002. So we consider some year as a palindromic year. For example, 2002. So will you mute yourself? So we have some years which has a considered as a palindromic year. For example, 2002. Will you tell me an example for the palindromic year? So in 2002. So when we read it from left to right and right to left, we have the same number 2002, then 2002. Will you tell me some other example for this? So then one more example is 1991. So in this also, with this year is considered as a palindromic year. We have the palindromic date also, that is August 10, 2018, that is 8102018. We consider this date as a palindromic date. The next term is ambigram. So this ambigram, when we view from the all direction, it has the same symmetrical words. For example, here example is swim. So when we look at these words swim from right to left or upside to down, it has the same visual symmetrical pattern. So we consider this as an ambigram. So in July 20, we celebrated International Ambigram Day. So the next one is isogram is otherwise known as heterogram or non-pattern words. So then isogram, in a word, each letter is used in the same number of lines. So here I quote one example, that is dialogue. So this word we have, there is no repetition in this word. D-I-A-L-O-G-U-E. There is no repetition. So then each letter, it is used in the same number of times. So based on that, we have first order isogram, second order isogram, and third order isogram. So in the first order isogram, there is no repetition. The word it contains, mainly there is no repetition in this letter. So one more example for this is uncopyrightable. So in this word uncopyrightable, there is no repetition. So we consider this as a first order isogram. The next one is second order isogram. So in the second order isogram, so unless the letter is repeated only for twice, for example is deed, D-E-E-D. So in this word, the letter is repeated only twice. Then we have third order isogram also. So in the third order isogram, the letter is repeated for three times. For example, sestets, S-E-S-T-T-E-T-S. So in this word, the letter S, E and T is repeated for three times. So that's why we consider this as a third order isogram. So we have some most common facts in English language. English is considered as the happiest language because the word ho and happy, it appears three times when compared to the word sad. So that's why we consider English as the happiest language. So then we have some most common facts, that is the most common adjective we used in English is good. The most common noun is time. The word set has the highest number of definition in English language. Then, the word town is considered as the oldest English word still we are in use. Then, the letter E is used maximum of time in English language in Oxford Dictionary. The least number of letter which occupy in the dictionary is Q. So when we compare these two letters, E and Q, E is 56 times more common than Q. So that's why E is considered as common used letter in English language. Only 90% of English text consists of 1,000 words. So even though we have more than lakhs of words in dictionary, we have used only 1,000 words for the text. So even though we have enormous words in English language, there are only two words that ends in G-R-Y. That is angry and hungry. So when you go for the analysis of this, we never found any other word that ends with G-R-Y. So the next one, the common phrase which we use is goodbye. So when you want to leave from some place or from someone, we use this phrase goodbye. This phrase goodbye comes from the old English phrase, that is God be with you. We have some shortest and longest word in English language. The shortest grammatical sentence is go. The shortest and oldest word and common used word in English language is I. So this, the word I, it has the sentence same also. Then the longest word in English is 5 times, 45 letters. So any one of you, will you read this word? Some of you, you already have come across this word. The word which contains 45 letters in dictionary is considered as the longest word. So any one of you, will you read this word? So as the topic today we are having is communication. So then communication is just sharing our ideas. It might be effective when it is Nicole.
Can I read it?
Yeah.
Pneumona ultra microscopic silicarachnoconiosis.
Okay, good attempt. So then this is the longest word in English dictionary which contains 45 letters. This is the name of the lung disease. So when we inhale the smoke from the volcano, we have this disease. So that's why this is termed like that. The next one, the longest English word in the world which contains 189,819 letters. They consider this as the longest English word in the world, but it's not placed in the dictionary. So it almost take over 3 hours to say this word. So it is the chemical name for a titin protein. It's a huge protein. It's the name of the, it's a chemical name for a protein. So then, do you have the habit of reading newspaper?
Yes, ma'am.
Then how many of you read English newspaper? So when we read the report of an English newspaper, they have used some different terms. So we don't know the pronunciation for some words. So when someone asks you to read those particular report or the article, so then we skip certain words, which is unfamiliar to you. So that we refer, that is referred as fear of long words. So we have a fear whether we mispronounce those words. So that's why we skip those words. It's a kind of a phobia. We called that as a hippopotamonstrosis stupidilophobia. So this is the term we used to have the fear of long words. The next, in English language, so we consider only 4 words as a magic words. Those 4 magic words are thank you, excuse me, please, and sorry. So we can use these words in our day-to-day communication to please anyone. So then, if you need something, if you use the word please, definitely we can get it. So then if someone helps you, we should show our gratitude by using the word thank you. So then if something happened in a wrong manner, we can use sorry. So then if you want to get some information from someone, we'll use the phrase excuse me. So that's why we consider these 4 words are the magic words in English language. So then next we come to the core of the today series, that is communication. So as we know that communication is the sharing our thoughts to someone. So then when during the communication, the 2 process has taken place. One is encoding and decoding. So what I am doing now, just I'm sharing my ideas and thoughts to you. So now I'm the sender, you are the receiver. What I am sending, just I am sending the message. So encoding, it refers, so for conveying some ideas and thoughts, just I select some words and symbols and pictures to represent the message to you. So that's why first I have chosen some words, then I make the PPT. Just I use the medium, that is a virtual mode, to convey my message. So encoding, it involves the idea and thoughts of a person. So then what is decoding? So when I'm conveying the message to you, if the message is understood by you, that process is called as a decoding process. So then when I ask a question to you, the question which is in my mind, that is encoding. For example, just I want to know your name. So that's why just I raise a question to you. What is your name? So that is encoding. The message is, what is your name? So then when you understand my question, so decoding process has taken place in your mind. So when you understand my question, the reply is considered as the feedback. So that's what in this image, encoding, the message was delivered. So then decoding has taken place. That's the mind of the receiver. So when they understand the message, they reply them in a form of feedback message. This is how the communication process has taken place. The effective communication is done only when the message is received and understood by the receiver. Now, just I wish to convey something to you. Just I use the medium of communication is, that is a virtual mode. The language which I prefer is English language, which is familiar language for you. So I thought that this communication might be effective because the message which I wish to deliver to you, it might be understood from you. So then this is considered as effective communication. So then if I choose some other language such as Hindi or Telugu or Malayalam, which is unfamiliar to you, so whatever effort I put to deliver the message, if that language is unfamiliar to you, definitely decoding process does not has taken place. You couldn't understand the message. When you fails to understand the message, so then there's a flaw in the communication. So before you are going to communicate the idea or thoughts to someone, we could understand the level of the listener. So the next one, then in this slide, what is communication? So what is happening there? A girl and a boy is dining. So then both of them, they are tasting the different food. Here the sender is the girl, so then the receiver is the boy. So when they are having the different food, the sender, that is the girl, she just sent a message to the boy that your food smell delicious. So when that message was understood by the receiver, that is boy, he just gave the feedback, that is thanks. So then from uttering the sentence your food smell delicious, he could understand that she is indirectly wants to taste the food. Sometimes when you are sharing the food with someone, to your friend, so when you like your friend's food, just you give the feedback that your food seems so tasty. So in that, indirectly just we want to inform them that we need more. Sometimes indirect, we can send some indirect message also. So then here the sender is a girl who sent the message, that is your food smell delicious. So when that message was understood by the receiver, he could interpret the meaning, that is he could understand the meaning, then he sent the feedback, that is thank you. Okay. So the next one is medium of communication. So then when we communicate to someone, we'll choose a different medium. So then what do you understand from this slide? So just I have inserted some images in that slide, medium of communication. So almost we have more than 10 images are there. The first one, just we communicate through spoken form. That is the first image. The next one, we can communicate through virtual mode. It might be in a form of email or some other thing. Then we can communicate with other by whispering. So we can communicate through newspaper, or telephone communication, written communication, through advertisement, through listening, by letter, television, and radio. So could you find out what was the medium of communication, the last one? The last image, it depicts that She just communicate in a non-verbal form. Okay, from that image, we could understand she just want to express her emotion. She might be in the depression or in a anger. So we can choose the medium for communication. So communication is classified into two types based on the channel, communication channel, and based on the style and purpose. So based on the channel, we have verbal and non-verbal communication. So verbal means that is using language. So then, as I mentioned you already, so then language is a medium for communication. So then the verbal, it might has taken place in a two form, that is it might be in oral communication or written communication. So in non-verbal communication, we have some gestures, postures, and facial expression. It comes under non-verbal communication. So based on the purpose, the communication is classified into formal and informal communication. If you want to communicate with your friend, the language which you chosen is informal language. For example, hi dude, hi dear, hello, nice to meet you. So then the language which we have chosen is informal language. So in formal communication, when you want to communicate your ideas or thoughts to someone officially, we'll choose a formal communication. For example, you can communicate through letter, you can communicate through email. So for this purpose, we'll use the formal language. So then, when we communicate, verbal and non-verbal communication, it plays a important role. If you want to interact with someone, if you are admired by the listener, we should use both verbal and non-verbal communication. So in a conversation, 35% verbal communication and 65% non-verbal communication has taken place. So if you want to deliver a content to someone, you choose only 35% as a verbal, that is language. So the remaining 65% we choose for non-verbal clues. Then only that communication seems to be effective. So then you have noticed a famous orator. They have chosen the language. Within that, they have chosen some non-verbal clues. The non-verbal clues are the facial expression, tone of voice, movement, appearance, eye contact, gesture, and posture. So during our communication process, we use language. Within that, we'll use these non-verbal clues to admire the listener. So then, in the stage performance, in the public speaking, so without any non-verbal clues, if you convey your ideas to the audience for 5 minutes, it seems to be very bold. So when you have seen the famous orator, they use non-verbal communication to admire the audience. The next one, we come to the point that is effective communication. When a person has the ability to convey the information to other effectively and efficiently, we consider that communication is effective one. So if you want to communicate in an effective manner, we'll use the non-verbal clues which I have mentioned to you already. So we have some characteristics of effective communication. If a communication should be effective, the message should be clear and simple. It should be easy to understand. So when you communicate something to the kids, we should not use some standard words. So when you use some standard words, the kids, they couldn't understand. So if you want to communicate with someone, we have to choose the message which seems to be simple and it should be easy to understand the listener. So when we are communicating to someone, the information which we have chosen should not have any false sense. And it also free from the grammatical mistakes. Just I want to convey to you someone. Just I want to narrate some experience what I had on yesterday. So then I just afforded, just I uttered the sentence that I went to temple. This is the grammatical sentence. So instead of that, if I used I went to temple tomorrow, the listener, they are getting confused. So then they are in confusion what she tried to express. So that's why. So when we are uttering some statement, it should be free from the grammatical mistakes. The next one, the message, it should be complete one. It should not be an incomplete one. So when the message is incomplete, it leaves a wrong decision to the listener. For example, just I used to share something to you. Just I say, I bought. So when the sentence is incomplete, it's very hard to the listener to understand. It may confuse the reader, and it also leads the reader to have the wrong decision. Then the question raised, what did she buy? So that's why the message, it should be in a complete form. So whatever the speaker wish to convey, the message, it should be short and concise. Then the message, it should be reliable. We should convey only the correct message. We should not convey any wrong message. Then another one important thing is consideration of the recipient. We have to choose the medium of communication. We should have a proper plan to choose the medium of communication. So what I have mentioned in the previous slide. The last one is sender courtesy. The message which we convey, it reflects the sender's courtesy toward the receiver. That's why, based on the purpose, we have to choose informal communication or formal communication. So when you are taking seminar in the class to the students, if the teacher is unavailable, you can use some friendly tone. So when you are taking a seminar in front, when you are presenting a PPT in front of the huge audience, we should use the formal language. So the message which we wish to convey, it should reflect the sender's courtesy towards the receiver. The next one, everybody, we wish to become an effective communicator. So if you want to be an effective communicator, we should develop the following things which I have mentioned. We should possess the sharp observing skill, which is called as observance. We should listen. If you want to be a good orator, you should listen so many public speaking. So in each and every individual, they may differ from one another. So then we should have the sharp observing skill. The next one, the message which we wish to deliver to the audience, it should be clear and precise. If it is clear and precise, definitely it impacts the receiver. The next one, listening and understanding. So in the debate or a group discussion, if you are one among them, we should have the listening skill. Because from their points, we may have some idea to express our views. So we should have a listening skill and we should understand what others to say. So then there are some people who are involving in the group discussion. They never lend their ears to listen others' point of view. They always stick with their own point of view. So if you want to be an effective communicator, we should develop the listening and understanding skill. The next one, emotional intelligence. It plays a vital role to be an effective communicator. We should be always emotionally aware. So imagine that you are a debater. Just you are participating in a debate. Sometimes your points, it might be opposed by the other. When your points are being opposed, you should not express our emotion, such as anger or some other thing. So we should always aware of emotion. The next one is self-efficacy. So then everyone, we have a belief that we should have the ability to control our behavior and emotion and motivation. It's a very, very important skill. We should have a belief. If you want to be a good communicator, we should have a belief You should believe yourself that you could control your behavior or emotion. That's very, very important. Because we should not lose our temper when you are in the public speaking. So this is another important skill which we could inculcate. The next one, self-confidence. If you want to be a good communicator, we should have a confidence among ourselves. You have a confidence that you can. So in a class, when you ask someone to express their views in front of your friends, only few of them, they come forward. Then some others, they feel hesitate to come to share their ideas in front of others. So then this shows that they have a lack of confidence. The reason behind that is they have a fear. Even there are some students who couldn't face the audience also. They feel shy, they feel fear, they have a fear of the words which they have chosen to express their idea. They have a fear that whether they are mispronouncing certain words. So we have to overcome those fears, we have to overcome the shyness. So if you want to overcome, we should have a self-confidence. The next one is respectfulness. So when you are delivering the message to the audience, it should be in a respect to values. The next one is nonverbal communication. So then, as I told you, in a conversation, 65% has taken place the nonverbal communication. This nonverbal communication, it connects the audience in a better way. So may I know your famous orator? So we have admiration over some famous orator due to their nonverbal communication. The next one, so when you are communicating to someone, we have to select the right medium. So based on the situation, we have to choose the correct medium. So here, so when we are in the pandemic situation, just our college has planned to conduct the induction program through virtual mode. So we should have a proper planning to choose the correct medium. So then, I hope that you are gaining your knowledge through this induction program. The next one is providing feedback. A communication should be effective when it is in the two-way process. So then, we always ready to take and give the feedback to know the other perspective. So that's why each and every program, so then the speaker, they give the opportunity to the listener to provide the speaker, to provide the feedback. So from that, the speaker, they comes to know about the perspective of the audience. If you want to be a good communicator, you have to inculcate these communication skills. So during your communication process, the message which was said by the speaker, it should not be understood by the listener. So we consider that as a barrier of communication. So we have a number of barriers. Just I want to mention only few. Those barriers are physical barrier, perceptual barrier, emotional barrier, cultural barrier, language barriers, gender barriers, interpersonal barrier, and attitude barrier, lack of focus and eye contact, fear of mistakes. So these are the barriers for communication. So if you want to be a good communicator, if you want to communicate in an effective manner, you have to overcome these barriers. So in our conversation, we use certain words which does not have the meaning. We consider that as a filler or a crutch word. So when I ask you to talk something, so then we use some expressions such as going, coming. So this is due to the influence of mother tongue. So then we never have the idea in English language. So when we go for the translation, just we have the influence of the mother tongue. There are certain words which does not have the meaning or value. So we used those words in a casual conversation. So we should avoid those crutch words or the fillers in formal settings like public speaking or presentation. So we have used so many filler words in our conversation. Just I have mentioned only 5 common crutch words we used. So those crutch words are like, well, you know, literally and obviously. So these words, when you are using these words in a casual conversation, so then it spoils the effective of the communication. So then try to avoid, even though if you are using those words, you'll try to avoid to communicate in an effective manner. Then another important thing, if you want to improve our pronunciation and fluency, we should practice some tongue twister. So then when we are practicing our tongue twister, it helps to improve the accents. So when you are using those tongue twister, we can improve the accent by using the repetition of one sound. We have some simple tongue twister also. So if you want to, just you start to practice from the simple tongue twister. For example, the word red blood, blue blood. So in these phrases, so only particular sounds are repeating. So when we are repeating the particular sounds, your accents will be improved. So then, generally we are mispronouncing so many words in English language. So as per the, we are using the British language. So then our British accent is entirely different from our Indian accent. So then when you check your pronunciation in the pronunciation dictionary, the maximum words are mispronounced. Just I want to mention that the word pronunciation is the word which we mispronounce a lot. If you want to develop your fluency and pronunciation, just we'll try some tongue twisters. So you can, the tongue twister is not only in the English language. The tongue twisters are available in all other languages also. Even in our mother tongue, Tamil, we have some tongue twister. So then, if you want to communicate in an efficient manner, you practice the tongue twisters regularly. So then, will you tell me some tongue twister which is known? Here in this slide, just I have mentioned the tongue twister, that is, sixth sick shakes sixth sheep's sick. So in this example, the sound is repeatedly pronounced. So any one of you, will you try this tongue twister? Am I audible? Does any one of you come forward to try this tongue twister which I have mentioned in this slide? Sixth sick shakes sixth sheep sick.
Ma'am, picture not clear, ma'am.
Not clear. Okay, just tell me a tongue twister which you know already.
Ma'am, may I tell, ma'am?
Yes.
Betsy Wonder bought some butter, but the butter was bitter, so she bought better butter to make the bitter butter better.
Okay, good. So when we use the tongue twister, when we practice the tongue twister, definitely our accent will be improved. So then there are some common tongue twisters are also there. So just I wish to mention one. How much wood would a woodchuck chuck if a woodchuck could chuck wood? So then we have so many tongue twisters so that if you want to be improve your accent and pronunciation, you practice yourself by practicing those tongue twisters. So we have the world longest tongue twister we have. The world longest tongue twister contains 466 tongue tripping words. So we consider this as a world longest tongue twister. If you want to improve your communication, the tongue twister, then practice by communicating with others. We have so many ideas, but when we try to communicate in this language, sometimes we stammer. The reason we have hope that the today's session it might be useful for you, because you just come across some interesting facts in English language, and we just come to know the characteristics of the communication. Just I hope that today's session is useful for you.
Thank you, ma'am.